Broadcasting across California, California's only statewide political show. You're watching The Issue Is.
Welcome to a very special edition of The Issue Is. I'm Elex Michaelson, and with us this week is the longest serving governor in the history of California. Jerry Brown is here via Skype from his ranch in Colusa County, where our show airs on both ABC 7 and Fox 20. In 1975, Brown became California's 34th governor at just 36 years old. In 2019, he left the job as California's 39th governor at 80 years old. He's also served as California's Secretary of State, Attorney General, Chair of the Democratic Party, Mayor of Oakland, and more over 5 decades of service. Governor Jerry Brown is now his life story is profiled in Man of Tomorrow, The Relentless Life of Jerry Brown. It's a new book by Jim Newton of the LA Times. Governor Jerry Brown, welcome to The Issue Is for the very first time. Thank you so much for being here.
Great to be here.
I got to admit, Governor, when we started this show 2 years ago, you were the first person on our list that we wanted to have on the show. And we've been trying for 2 years, so the day has finally come.
Well, that must be someone in my office.
Yeah. Hopefully it'll be worth the wait, right? When we originally scheduled this conversation, you were supposed to be here, and we were supposed to talk a lot about that book that's just coming out this week. And we'll talk about that book in a moment. But now, of course, we're at this time of extraordinary peril for our state in the midst of this unprecedented coronavirus crisis. You've been through so many crises over the years. Help us. What's your advice? What should we be doing right now?
Well, I think the governor and all the people that work with him are doing everything they can. The problem is we don't have enough testing. And then with more testing, we need more tracing. And then with the tracing, we have to identify and isolate all the people who have potentially this virus and keep in quarantine for 2 weeks. That's what Taiwan did very early, and they really nipped it in the bud. We haven't done that. And I think the governor is trying his best to get more tests. He's ramping them up, but 30,000 tests a day. We need a couple hundred thousand at least. And if we're gonna have kids go back to school, we're gonna have to have a lot of them tested. Now, how do we get the tests? There's only one way. The President of the United States has to invoke the War Powers Act and mobilize American industry. So without any kind of rivalry or competition, they get down to the business of producing good tests, quick tests, reliable, and get the results back much quicker. That can be done. It was just announced today that China is going to administer 11 million tests in the city of Wuhan. If China, which is poorer than we are, has less sophisticated scientists and technology, then why can't we? There's only one reason. The president has abdicated. He's thrown the ball to the governors, who can do a lot and have a real role to play, like the mayors. But at the end of the day, we need a commander-in-chief like Roosevelt, who one day after Pearl Harbor said, no more private passenger cars. America's making Liberty ships, airplanes, and tanks. And we can put a ship in the water in a matter of days. Why can't America put 10 million tests out in a matter of days or weeks or even a month? We're not.
So why can't they? And why isn't the president doing that?
I think because it is, and I want to be fair about this, I think they believe that abstention, leaving the marketplace, the profit incentive to do the work. But in time of crisis, like war or pandemic, we need the mobilization of the country under the direction of the commander-in-chief. Anything less than that is going to be a start and stop operation. California, other states will open up. Then the virus will flare up again. Then we'll close, stop and start. It'll be devastating to the economy and very, very difficult to manage and unpleasant for the citizenry and probably liable to cause a lot of civic and political discord. So there's the path, not a pretty one, but there's only one man who has the key, and the key is currently Donald Trump. And so far, he's not opening the lock.
You were part of a coronavirus advisory board to Governor Newsom that's co-chaired by Tom Steyer. We had Tom Steyer on our show last week, and he said about your invaluable contributions, sort of taking a long view on this, talking about the importance of sustainability when it comes to the environment. What's your advice to that panel right now and your advice to the governor?
Certainly keep doing what they're doing, which is to identify all the businesses, what they need, what's the right tempo to reopen, be practical, at the same time, ramp up the tests, buy as many tests as you can, get the labs expanded, get the tracing people. Look, we have a lot of people who want to work, so we have these factories. California has scientists that invented techniques for genetic engineering. Certainly we can get a swab and get some chemical reagent so that we can test to find out who's got it and who doesn't. As long as we don't know, since this virus is invisible and is carried by half the people with no symptoms, you never know who carries it, who in your studio, who in the store in Williams, where I live nearby. Look, you got to test. You got to test over and over again. Watch the Chinese. Now, I'm not saying they're perfect. None of these countries are. But the fact is, they've only had less than 5,000 deaths. Some people say, well, they're not telling us. So double or triple it. If you double or triple it, it's a fraction of New York City, of New York. And New York is what, 20 million people, a few more? China's 1.4 billion. So you've got to do the basics. Test, trace, quarantine. And you have to be relentless about that. You cannot pussyfoot around or you're going to have this virus hanging on, destroying the economy, killing more people, and making more people suffer the horror. So, yeah, this is really serious, and America, in the guise of our president, because he's the only one that can mobilize industry, we're not doing what we need to do.
Do you miss being in there at a moment like this? And if you were in there, is there anything you would do differently than what's being done now?
Well, no, I don't miss being there because I can't quite see how we're going to avoid so much trouble. But I would say I remember somebody telling me, some contributor who used to be a contributor of mine, was giving to Pete Wilson. And I said, well, you know, why the hell are you supporting him? And he said this was a guy who represented a certain industry, and said, when our industry was in trouble, Pete Wilson, as a senator, went to the White House and he broke the China. By breaking the China, I thought was a metaphor for he got in the face of Reagan and got what his industry needed. And that was pretty impressive. So I think these governors have to go to the White House, either digitally or in person with a proper protection, and break the China. Get Trump to take the action that we have to take. Science tells us. And that means more testing. That means, by the way, money. You know, we had a depression and we had Roosevelt. Roosevelt said the New Deal. Well, it brought down the unemployment, but it was still 10 or 11% at 1941. So then we had Second World War. We need right now from our president and the Congress a fiscal investment, trillions of dollars. First of all, they got to help people who can't work to support their families. And then secondly, we have to invest and create the demand by investing in infrastructure and jobs, because 70% of the American economy is consumers buying stuff, going to Disney, going to restaurants, buying cars and gadgets. Well, that 70% is not buying. Therefore, the only other entity that can equal 70% of the American people is the American government. And we know it can work. Worked in World War II, worked in the Depression. Now, we need a new Roosevelt. If Trump wants to do that, great. If he doesn't want to do that, we got to get somebody else who will. It's that simple. I don't want to sound partisan, but you ask me, and this is not a matter of politics, it's a matter of fact and science. If you don't test, you don't know who has it. If you don't know who has it, they're going to be spreading it, and either you're going to want to close down or you're going to scare the hell out of everybody, and they're not going to go out and spend their money. So the only way to reverse this is for the big government intervention and for testing and to really do it. and to do it as quickly as possible. The longer we delay it, the more we're going to face unemployment and suffering.
You know, Governor Newsom, when I've asked him about President Trump, has said that the president has delivered everything that he's asked for, and he's grateful for the leadership of President Trump on this. Do you agree with that or you don't?
Well, he's gotten what he's asked for, but I'm just telling you, based on the experience, you know, forget about China, just take Taiwan. Taiwan did exactly what I'm talking about. And they did it not by having all the local mayors decide what to do, but by having the leadership in Taiwan, the head of the country, to order it through the power of government. That's what has to do, we need. And until Trump does this, I'm not going to give him any particular praise. I mean, yes, he gave some money and he's given hundreds of billions to California. Hallelujah. We need, that's good, but that doesn't get the job done. The job is twofold. Get the test, mobilize industry, make it happen like Roosevelt went from cars to Liberty ships. And number two, put out the money. The Federal Reserve is inexhaustible. It controls the dollar, and lend the money to business, small business, gig workers, and then prop up the spending power so people don't starve to death. Yes. It's pretty simple, and we're America, and we got all this power and money, but it is not yet happening at the level required to solve the problem.
You know, when I asked Governor Newsom about you and the advice that you're giving him, he said that you guys text back and forth, which I think was surprising for some folks. What is the nature of your relationship with the governor, and how involved are you in what's happening now?
Well, we're on this committee, and the committee is an advisor, and it's a big committee, so it's working through subcommittees. Tom Steyer is leading the way, and Governor Newsom's chief of staff. So, yeah, we have a few thoughts. But let's be honest, where did my thoughts come from? Well, my experience, but I'm reading the paper. I'm looking at my little phone here. I got my apps, so I'm checking stuff out. It's all available. Newsom has great advisors, great people working with him, and we have this wonderful digital media, so you can figure out what's going on in the world. So that's why what I say is my advice, and I would give it to all 50 governors, including the President of the United States. And it's not me, it's what the facts are telling us from successful countries. Yeah. I give you Taiwan as the best example.
When I interviewed Gavin Newsom during the campaign back in 2018, and I asked him specifically about you, and I want to play for you what he said about you and then ask you what you would say about him. Take a look. What are the lessons you've learned from watching him?
The guy's a master. He's the guy who invented chess. He's Kasparov. I mean, this guy's at a different level. We're playing checkers. He's 5-6 moves ahead. What makes no sense in the immediate moment all of a sudden presents a new perspective 6 months, a year later. He's just a remarkable human being.
What do you think of that, and how would you describe him?
I would say I accept the nomination. Sounds good. By the way, if there even is a shred of that over-the-top praise, then what I've said right now at least is worth giving a few moments of serious reflection. Secondly, what I said about Newsom, he's got a lot going for him. He's bright. He's got experience. He's mayor of a big, complicated city. And he's got a lot of good people around him, and he's got all this advice in the world. The big challenge is the cards he's being dealt are very difficult cards to play, even if you're Superman.
How do you think he's doing?
He's doing good. He's doing good. But are we doing good? Right. Is America doing good? Like, given all the factors, and that's another story.
You talked also about President Trump a lot already, but just want to sort of hammer home on the President Trump aspect of this. We saw this week a Republican likely to win in California's 25th district. Are you concerned that President Trump is going to win again in November and then not do a lot of the stuff that you just said? And if so, what would your advice be for the Democratic Party right now?
Good point. The gamblers, I noticed all the polls show Biden ahead by 4 to 6 points, but the 5 or 6 of the betting firms are betting on Trump. So there it is. It's at best, it's even money here. Well, no, it's not even money. It's more on Trump. But from my point of view, this is not clear who's going to win. And I do have concerns that in leadership, we have to, somebody has to take this bull by the horns and write it in the way that has to be done. Maybe that's a bad metaphor. We just need a commander in chief to do what Roosevelt did at a comparable time in American history. And so far, that's not happening. I would mention another one. Climate change is happening. And if we get four more years of climate denial, California, the forest fires we've seen now are going to get worse. And, you know, the PG&E spending, $13 billion, $20 billion, it's going to double, triple. So, look, we have problems that we can work on with reasonable solutions. But you've got to follow science, and you have to use the power that we have. So am I concerned? Yes. Your final question, what should the Democrats do? I would just say the candidate's Biden, and Joe Biden's got to present that Rooseveltian alternative crisply, effectively, and eloquently now and every day between now and the election.
We're looking at sort of a fiscal cliff here in California. You have worked so hard to create this big surplus. You've been such a fiscal hawk in so many instances. If we do have to make cuts, which we probably do, what should be cut? Should high-speed rail be cut? Should pensions be cut? How do we make this work? How do we balance our budget?
Well, first of all, you use that nice rainy day fund that we built up. Secondly, you don't cut high-speed rail. You don't cut investments in roads, in bridges, in hospitals, in schools. You keep the spending going. That's why the Depression went on so darn long. They didn't put enough money out to solve the problem. Even in the 2008-2009 financial debacle, there wasn't enough of a bailout of an investment, so the unemployment went higher and lasted longer. What we need is to invest in broadband in all the rural communities. We can't let our rural hospitals go bankrupt. So you got to borrow and you got to invest, and that's going to take the federal government helping us. So we got to get this right. And if you pull in and circle the wagons and don't use the firepower of the Federal Reserve and the power, the spending power of Washington, we're in real trouble. Now, in the short term, you got the debit, you've got the rainy day fund, and then you have internal funds you can borrow. It's going to be painful, but what Schwarzenegger did, and was still going on when I was governor the first couple of years, you defer spending to local schools and government, and then they have to go out and borrow. And in many ways, they can borrow easier than the state, because they can't really borrow without a vote of the people. So, look, it's not easy, but there are a lot of ways that the downturn can be managed, assuming it doesn't get prolonged too long. If we don't do the testing and we get a second wave here, then Katie barred the door.
Do you think it's time to reform pensions in this state?
Well, there's a case pending before the California Supreme right. Court that raises the question, are vested rights subject to modification if the employee has not yet earned that part of the pension? The example is you're 10 years into the job, you got 20 years to go to retirement. Does the amount you've been promised now, can it be modified for those 20 years that you haven't worked yet? I say yes. The Supreme Court's going to tell us. I brought those suits myself. The governor's office had to bring it, have our own lawyer. That lawyer is still there. They're arguing the case. There's this one. All of, many of the cities have joined in. Depending on what the Supreme Court rules, there may be more flexibility. So I think the flexibility of the pensions is going to have to come. I would not stop spending on immediate funding because, they're going to do that. We did before, they cut 30,000 teachers out. That could happen again because the state doesn't have money. If you go to a certain point, you get to IOUs. So we're not there yet, But this is not a great place to be. And given the abstention from Washington, we could be forced into some very austere, very tough choices. But at the very least, I certainly hope the courts are going to give us some flexibility here, give the state flexibility, or it's just going to be that much more drastic in the impact that we're going to have to. And we know what that is. The tuition doubled because the state cut back on the University of California and state colleges. That's going to happen again. It isn't easy. That's why I put such an emphasis on building up a surplus. And I have to tell you, the fact that we didn't have a recession, that was luck. I mean, that was just the way things happened with the global economy. But now we got it, and we got to be very careful in how we spend money. And everybody, we got to share the pain. And because some people are a lot better off, you can't share it equally. You have to share it disproportionately. Those are the most, I would say, those are the biggest belts. Got to pull them in more. Those at the bottom 20, bottom 30%, they have no savings. So you can't put more burden on them.
We continue our conversation with Jerry Brown, the four-term governor of California. Governor, we want to talk a little bit about you, specifically a couple new books that have come out about you. We want to put those up on the screen. The first one is called Man of Tomorrow. It's a book by Jim Newton of the LA Times, just came out this week. The other one, we want to put that up on the screen as well, an exceptional book called The Browns of California, The Family Dynasty That Transformed a State and Shaped a Nation. That came out last year. I've got my copy of that. I've ordered the Jim Newton book, which I'm excited to get in the mail soon. Let's talk for a moment about why you did not make the decision to write an autobiography. Some politicians, they get out of office, they make a lot of money, they put together these autobiographies that are very self-referential. Why did you decide to let somebody else tell your story?
Well, I've tried. I've written hundreds of pages, so it may come out someday. One thing I find out, politics is not as heroic as I would want. If you talk about General Patton, or you talk about someone who saves children from a burning building, there's a drama there. There's heroics. But when you talk about politicians, I mean, what do? They want to get their mug on television. They go around talking to wealthy people, trying to get money from them. They hang out with industries and lobbyists that can finance their campaigns. They put out a lot of press releases. They do the obvious because they got to keep half the people happy. So when you try to sit through a book and say, okay, let's be deep here. What is the meaning of it all? What is going to touch someone's soul? There's not as much there as you might think, and that's why political biographies are very rare. And I once asked, who's done the best political biography? And the word that came back to me was Ulysses Grant, which is a biography. I mean it to read it, because that's supposed to be maybe the best that a politician ever wrote.
Well, I mean, I think your story is about as fascinating as you can. One of the aspects that's so fascinating about your story is you're not the first Governor Brown. Of course, your father was the two-term governor of California as well. What do you think is the most important lesson that he taught you that shaped your worldview as governor?
I don't think there's one lesson. There's a lot of lessons. When they always talk about my father's a builder, so I certainly want to build a few things like the tunnels to make sure the water is flowing and we preserve the fish up in Northern California. And then, of course, the high-speed rail, which I think is part of the future. So many countries have it. And I know it's a big investment, but we got to think big. The other thing, though, that I have to say very immediate, since my father had a recession at the end of his term, just like his predecessor, Goodwin Knight, and Reagan took advantage of that to talk about the bloated budget and the deficit and all the rest of it. So I said, oh boy, I don't want to do that. Now, when I was governor, I had two recessions. Actually, I started with the recession, which Reagan had. Then we had another one a couple of years before I finished, and then right at the end. So, and then I saw Gray Davis run into a recession, and it didn't help his popularity. I saw Schwarzenegger go from very high in the surveys to very low with a big recession. So when I said to myself, we're not going to have a budget deficit this time around. And so we did. And so that's a lesson. The lesson is, when we get in a recession, California gets a deficit. If it's a big deficit, it's a big deficit. And people say, what the hell did the governor do? He play with the books? He didn't manage things right. Now, the truth is, it's the economy, mostly. But that is just one of the factors of being a governor. Dodge recessions if you can. Dodge deficits. I wanted to give a little formula, you know, bumper sticker. Dodge deficit. That would be my blue and white bumper sticker for a candidate for governor.
You've also talked about politics, and I think you view politics in some moral terms that maybe other people don't. You have, of course, Jesuit training. You were almost a priest. How do you think that changed the way that you maybe see the nature of politics itself that some of your other colleagues did not?
Well, interestingly, by the way, that's my grandmother right there next to my father, and between my father and my sister. And where I'm talking from right now is about 300 feet from the first mountain house where my grandmother grew up. And so I'm right here in what I call Mountain House 3. The first one was built in 1855, second one in 1907, third one in 2018, which my wife and I put together. So there we are. I just couldn't refrain from making that point. So ask your question again.
The question about the fact that you had that Jesuit training and how that shaped your worldview and view of politics that way other people's didn't.
Yeah. Now, here's the point. That the quest for God or for ultimate meaning is it's a profoundly important quest. So to the extent that I've devoted myself to seeking that kind of a answer, that kind of, it's not really a problem, it's more of a quest. It's about the fundamental things. And so that made me very inclined to think, well, what's really important? We're doing, you know, we have thousands of bills introduced. You have many, many activities of state government. And there's lots of news stories, lots going on. But my background has inclined me to go to the most fundamental, most profound issues. That's why climate change has captured my imagination, because it's so profound, it's so irreversible, and it affects so many human beings and so much of nature. The other issue that has my interest, the danger of a nuclear blunder, of having these nuclear weapons go off, either by intention, more likely by accident, that can kill hundreds of millions or maybe extinguish the human race. And that's why the president has the power himself to press the button. If he orders in 2 hours a nuclear strike on Russia, they retaliate, humanity's gone. So that's a big, profound issue. Climate change, nuclear, and I would say pandemic is right up there too. And given the population growth, given the vast acceleration in mobility, we're going to have pandemics for a long time to come. So we got to get ready. We got to respond. That's what's important. A lot of the other stuff we're talking about, you can do a little more, a little less. But these issues, climate change, pandemic, nuclear blunder, there's no room for accident. It really wipes out everything up to humanity itself if we don't do it right.
A couple more quick questions about you, because I know you love talking about yourself. You started as governor at 36 years old. You ended as governor at 80. What did the 36-year-old not realize that the 80-year-old did? I mean, obviously, that's a whole lifetime of experience, but sort of the biggest thing, if you had to pick one.
Well, I would have to say that managing... Well, first of all, things aren't easy to do. You know, everything is harder. Getting stuff done is more difficult than you think. Number two, that everybody is part right, part wrong. Everybody's got flaws. I don't care whether it's Trump or Obama or Biden or myself. for you. There's a lot of flaws in human beings, so that's why these organizations are imperfect. And that's why a good understanding of what's realistic is profoundly important. And being around for another 28 years between the last time I was governor and this time, it gave me more life experience, more experience with people to see what worked, what didn't, and get a sense of the passingness. One of the things you know at 82 that you don't know at 36, time is limited, and time goes very fast. So you want to focus on the important things, friendship, what's important in life, the basics, and not get too sidetracked on the bubbles and illusions that, quite frankly, keep our economy going, because that's the world. We're in a world of illusions and bubbles, and right now we can't buy as many as we need to keep our economy going. That's why I say we need the president to mobilize us and to stimulate the economy like Roosevelt did in 1933.
And one of the other things you had that second time around that you didn't have the first time around was your wife, Ann Gust. How did she change you?
I don't know that she has. She'd like to, but I still have my flaws and my other habits are still pretty much intact. In fact, I would say that since I actually went to the Sacred Heart Novitiate, which was billed as a place of perfection, life perfection, and you think you're going to get perfect. Well, I can tell you now, these 60 years later, I'm not perfect. We don't get perfect. We're dealing with a very messy, imperfect world and personalities. So my wife, she makes up for my deficiencies, and I would say that's what's happened. I wouldn't say things altered that much. And we get along very well because we're different, but we're very compatible. Well, I would say complementary, by no means the same.
We continue our conversation with Jerry Brown, the former governor of California. You are at your ranch in Colusa County, California. Tell us a little bit about what life is like there for you and a little bit more about sort of what you're doing these days.
Well, I'm talking to you over Skype, so that's good. There are my two dogs. They're in the next room, and they'd be barking like crazy. You see that? Yeah, Mountain House 3. I have things I'm doing. I've started an institute, California China Climate Institute at Berkeley, UC Berkeley, and that's just getting off the ground. We've had some dialogues with China. We want to get California, with all that we've learned working with provinces in China, to reduce carbon emissions. So that's an important thing. I'm also the chairman of the Oakland Military Institute, a school of about 650 kids, sixth grade through 12, a college prep school, in collaboration with the California National Guard, and that's a school that is quite unique, and it's a college prep school trying to help kids in Oakland and the surrounding area prepare themselves for the rigors of college. So that's something I have to spend a lot of time on. And then I'm the executive chairman of the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists, and they put out weekly publications through the internet, and we also put out the Doomsday Clock, which tells you how close we are to doomsday. And for those of you who hadn't heard about it, we were 2 minutes to doomsday. We moved the clock 20 seconds ahead and shifted from minutes to seconds. So we're 100 seconds from the apocalypse because of the danger of a nuclear miscalculation, the mounting climate change, the unsettling effects of cyber warfare and cyber interference, and then the pandemic. So there's a lot that could go wrong in a very big way. And the big people running the show are not handling things in the way that is needed to prevent the doom. So that's what I'm doing. But I'm also chasing rattlesnakes when they show up outside my door, and trying to keep my dog from eating the rabbits. We've got the irrigation. We got olive trees. We make Mountain House olive oil, and the irrigation breaks because the squirrels chew at it. The water is kind of mineralized, so the the emitters would get clogged. So there's always plenty to do, and it's very exciting. And neighbors are very friendly. We shop at a place called Full Belly Farms, and we go there every couple of weeks, and we help get stuff for our neighbors. They get stuff for us. So actually, it's a very exciting life. People are very nice out here, and even though my closest neighbor is a mile and a half away, my second neighbor is probably 10 miles away, people are closer even when they're in the next apartment. I have found that living out here in Calusa County.
As we wrap things up with Governor Jerry Brown, two last key questions for you. One, what do you see as your legacy? What do you want people to think of when they think of Jerry Brown?
I think you should think about whatever comes to your mind. I'm not going to try to guide you on that, but I would say overall, my most important work and what I think I did more of and more successfully was work on climate change. The fact that we have 30% renewable electricity, the fact that we have half the electric cars, the zero emission cars in the country, the fact that we have and had the first building efficiency standards, which I launched when I was governor the first time, and they've improved every 10 years since then. This is an area that is global and it's local. It affects everybody, in fact, in all of nature. So I think that's an area where, because of my concern about the ultimate issues, I focused a lot of my time. And in California, luckily, because people before me did something similar, previous governors, we were in a position to really put California in a world position of dealing with climate change. I'm sure there's a lot of other things. If you read those books, you'll find they're interesting. Take a look at them. I think they're interesting. And I think one of the most interesting things of all is the fact that my great-grandfather, when he got to California in 1852, he left Germany, which was called Prussia, the place where he was. He left from Hamburg, 1849, and he left on a ship called Perseverance. Mm. And I didn't know that until very recently. But I like that. And when I was in St. Brendan's Grammar School, my eighth grade nun, Sister Alice Joseph, always said, perseverance, perseverance. Usually she would say that when I was rather, when I wasn't doing my homework or paying attention in the proper manner. So perseverance was an early and late virtue that I've come to appreciate very much.
Do you have any big disappointment or one thing you were like, I wish I got that done?
You know, to be honest, I don't feel too disappointed. I feel very blessed in my where I am right now. Wife, being able to walk on the same path as my grandmother, who I knew. She lived 96 years, died when I won the nomination for governor the first time. So there's a lot of good things. I really appreciate all the people I've met. So, and I've got a lot of things I want to do. And so, yeah, if I made mistakes, you bet I made mistakes. And you're not going to get me to admit them, and I'm not going to elaborate on them. But I hopefully have learned from them. And I'll make more mistakes before I get finished.
And last question. The book about you is called Man of Tomorrow. What do you see as California's tomorrow? What does that look like?
Well, first of all, I want to say the author and the publisher, they could have easily, at 82, said the man of yesterday. Hmm. But they felicitously decided to call me the man of tomorrow. Now, how many tomorrows I got is an open question here. But what do I say? Read those books and you'll know about as much as... Actually, maybe they'll write a few more books. So I'm not going to tell you, but there's information... Go to Wikipedia, it's all there.
No, I mean broadly, not even really about you, but just about the state as a whole. You're known as somebody who's so forward-looking, who is able to look into the future more than other people have. Where do you see our state's future going, big picture?
That's a good question. We got, I never could have dreamed that Silicon Valley would turn into what it became. The explosion of Apple started, I think, when I was just starting to run for governor. Qualcomm, Google, Intel, Facebook, all these things are amazing. So what can we do going forward? I think it's automatic. Maybe we'll solve this pandemic. We'll get a vaccine. There's a lot of things that will get a better hold on climate change. We'll figure out better battery technology. We'll find out how to sequester carbon. There's a lot we can do. And so that's very exciting. Now, things will also go downhill because we're very, we've got a lot of costs. We have a lot of people without a lot of income. We've got a lot of inequality and a lot of discontent. And a lot of challenges. So I'd say, like life always, it's open. And we're not destined one way or the other. We have a lot of upside, but we got enough downside to keep us worried and should keep us worried. Or as I think St. Paul said, we should work out our salvation in fear and trembling. Mm. With some optimism and courage and exuberance and zest. That would be my formula.
Let's leave it there. We always like to play music on this show. This is your first time on the show, so we chose a song that made us think about you. This is California Dreamin' that we have. The little mamas and the papas, as we thought this is fitting for you as somebody who's made so many dreams come true in this state. And California has made so many dreams come true for you as well. Governor Jerry Brown, this is one of my favorite conversations we've ever had on this show. We waited 2 years. It was worth the wait. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jerry Brown. Thank you for watching. Thanks for watching The Issue Is. We'll see you next time.